Hello, Sideman. Thank you so much for coming on to Anyone But Me series. It is beautiful to have you. A lot of people may not know that we've known each other for a very long time for very, very strange reasons, but you basically bigged up my music from the beginning. So it's always love. It's always...
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I'll never forget going live just from hearing your music. I went live on Instagram just to let people know this girl is so amazing at what she does.
Bless
so amazing
you.
At singing and just conveying the feeling. And
thank
I feel
you.
Like that's that there's you know, making a song and then there's conveying your thoughts through a song. And sometimes those are two very different things.
No, for sure, for sure. I mean, I feel like back then I had like zero, I didn't really have like a following, and I was just kind of like getting into the industry a little bit, and mm-hmm. I was just hanging around in studios, and it just took one little video, and I don't know how you found it, but you just popped up, and I was like amazed by how much you were supporting.
It was my friend Andre. He had posted it on his Instagram, and I messaged him like, who is that? Because like I like when I hear a song that just, like, you know what I mean, just makes me feel something. I do like that, and just to see how you've blown up has just been absolutely amazing.
Thank you so much, and same to you. Same to you, just watching your progression and also your progression into being comedian, but also being someone who has a voice and who uses your platform in so many different ways. I feel like you're not only funny, you're motivational, you're politically charged, and I feel like that is, my favorite comedians are the ones that not only use, because I think you've got to be, there's a level of intellect when you're a comedian. And I feel like you're using your platform to raise awareness, but also just make sure people are good and motivate people is beautiful. We love to see it.
Thank you.
No, it's amazing. I wanted to get you on here today because of that reason, and because I've just found your platform and how you're using it so incredible. And we were just having a chat now about Elephant and Castle and how you used to live in Elephant.
Yeah, I used to live in Elephant.
Yeah, and how I'm saying, and you're originally from Birmingham.
Yeah, I'm originally from Birmingham.
And I was saying how much I love Birmingham, and you were saying how much you love Elephant.
Yeah, no, Elephant. Elephant was a really nice place to live. And you know what? Elephant gave me Jamaica vibes. I was born in Jamaica, innit?
Really?
And like, yeah, walking down Woolworth Road gave me Jamaica vibes. Just that you might see somebody shouting to their friend across the road kind of thing. And it's just like that. There was a community feel. I'm seeing people that look like me. Like, it was a great way to be introduced to London.
To London.
That was the, yeah. To not feel like such a culture shock or such a change, just to be in that environment. And I really enjoyed it.
There's so many like uncles that I know just from, so my dad, I know, maybe I shouldn't say this. I've got family that live on Woolworth Road. I've grew up in Elephant, but I grew up near, more towards the roundabout. And when you go down Woolworth Road, the thing that I love about it is it still doesn't feel like it's been gentrified.
Yeah.
As much as the rest of Elephant has been mad gentrified, like Woolly Road stays the same. And the characters of Woolly Road, especially outside Paddy Power and William Hill.
Yeah.
My goodness. Like,
and outside Morrison's as well.
No, literally outside Morrison's. Yeah. Bagel King is just like it's like a little mecca within Elephant and Castle, and everyone congregates there. And I feel like I felt that kind of community spirit when I was in Birmingham. Because as I was saying to you, like when we get given regional shows as a musician and stuff, I think you're kind of, if you're from London, you're kind of like, oh, what's it going to be like in these cities or in these towns? Like, are they going to get where I'm coming from? Obviously, I'm out here singing songs like London Mine, which is one of my songs called London Mine is about celebrating immigrants. Mm-hmm. And it was written, I actually wrote it when the first kind of, the first news about the Windrush scandal was coming out, and how Amber Rudd was burning Windrush Generation's papers and sending back people to Jamaica, even though they'd never grown up there. And I felt like that was a really telling time, and it really showed how the country we live in views immigrants.
Yeah.
And I wanted to write a song that was just like celebrating us and making a statement that London wouldn't be London without us, without
people
like us.
Definitely.
100%. And then, so going over to Birmingham, I was, you know, you get nervous. You're kind of like, are they going to understand this kind of message? Da, da, da. And I have to say that Birmingham was my favorite city on tour, 100%. I've never seen such a community. And also, not only the like, all the different races, but also the different ages, the different, like, you've got dads with their daughters, you've got, like, young girls, you've got older women, you've got women that are bringing their daughters, et cetera, et cetera. And it just felt so, it felt so, like, warm and also so mixed, just like London.
Yeah, it's a very diverse city. And growing up in Birmingham, it's like, I never felt underrepresented, especially where I lived. I always felt like I saw myself and I saw other cultures as well. Yeah. And I was making mention to you earlier that the black and brown community really grew up very close together and closely knit in Birmingham, to the point where I felt like they were my brothers as much as anybody else. Like, like, and that's not even like a no pandering thing. Like, for me, it's just always been like that from growing up in my school. We're still friends to this day. Yes. So I'm with a lot of my friends. So it's just like, that's how it felt. But same thing for me coming to London, because I did my first show. I did my first London show. I just put on a stand-up show in London last year. I had less than a month to promote it, and it sold out, and London absolutely supported, man. And it was a great feel. Obviously, I'm going to be more used to doing comedy in Birmingham. I had done comedy before in London, but now it's my own show I'm hosting. I don't know if people are going to buy the tickets. I don't know what kind of pulling power I might have here. But seeing the support from people was absolutely amazing. So I think,
No, they really have so much similarity, I think, as cities. And what you're saying about black and brown community is very interesting for me, because I grew up in Elephant, which is, like you said, when you go down Woolley Road, it's like Jamaica. When you go down, let's say, there's certain parts of Woolley Road that's also very Ghanaian, very Nigerian. Mm-hmm. There's little bits, the stores outside Elephant and Castle. I used to buy jollof from a South African woman. So you've got all these different African countries, making their mark in Elephant, and also you have the Caribbean community, and you have a kind of smaller Asian community, but this, we're still here. So on my street, for example, my neighbor was Bayesian, and the neighbor beside was Bangladeshi, and then the neighbor beside that was Nigerian or British, and then the neighbor after that was Jamaican. And it was kind of like growing up in a very integrated street and community really shaped who I am, I think. And especially coming from a Bangladeshi community, where unfortunately I feel like, not that it's unfortunate, I just think that a lot of the Bangladeshi community actually, they're in East London famously. So you've got like Tower Hamlets, and like back in the 70s you had the Battle of Brick Lane. So a lot of Bangladeshi people from Sylhet particularly, which is a northern district of Bangladesh, moved over to London and occupied Tower Hamlets, and that was where they lived, and they really did fight to be there, and they dealt with a lot of racial issues, etc., from the previous people that would live there and stuff. But I feel like it's a very segregated area. It's very much, this is Bangladeshi, and in East you still have a lot of mix, but particularly Aldgate East, Whitechapel, you've got a very, very Bangladeshi, Sylheti community. And I feel like being Bangladeshi and growing up somewhere where it wasn't that, and I was, you know, I think I was in my year at school here, I was the only Bangladeshi kid. I was the only Bangladeshi kid, maybe one or two of us, and then everyone else was either Latin or black.
Oh, really?
100, yeah. And there was definitely other Bangladeshi people in the school, but then I did also go to a Catholic primary school. So Bangladeshis are Muslim, so it was a bit. But my cousin went as well. And I feel like, I don't know, I feel like it's really shaped me as a person, but also in times like this, it's made me be really aware of allyship, and also just be aware of how I grew up and how important that upbringing was for me to be as much of an ally as I can during this situation that we're in. This basically is like a revolution. And I feel like, I often say to my friends, if a black person's in a room and they've just had a racist comment said to them, or something's just happened to them that's made them uncomfortable, surely the person that they should be able to turn to in the room, if there's no other black people, is a brown person. you know, and surely there should be a
kinship and an understanding there.
Exactly, exactly. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, I feel like we can't deny that we're looking at a government that loves saying BAME and loves saying that they have BAME people in it, and it's just South Asians. It's just Priti Patel, Sajid Javid, Munira Mirza, you know, Rishi Sunak, and I don't feel represented by these South Asians myself. And then they're just using these people as, oh yeah, yeah, we've got them, we've ticked the box, we don't need black people in cabinet. That doesn't make any sense to me.
What they do a lot of the times is they get placeholders that were never authentic to their community anyway. And so it doesn't do the community any service. It's literally a box ticker, because we never feel represented by some of the people that they purport, because they're puppets and they brought people in. What is the point? When we ask for ourselves to be represented, it's not just in the color of the person's skin. It's also in representing our views, our issues. So we don't just feel that it's almost an insult to our intelligence.
Oh, 100%.
Let's just put a black person there, or let's just put an Asian person there, and then that will fit the quota, and then they'll feel okay. No, what's the person saying? Do you understand what I'm saying? And I think that will get called out a lot in this time. But what I will say is, where I have to really commend the brown community is that the brown community suffers so much also, right? And I think it's really beautiful that from what I've seen on social media, there has been such support from the brown community for the Black Lives Matter movement, without doing that whole thing of what about us as well? Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I think that's beautiful, because when you're hurting, sometimes it's very difficult to see somebody else's hurt. And it's not like the Asian community isn't going through its own hurt. So it's very different when somebody has to like kind of put aside their hurt for a second and say, okay, let's help this person and their pain. I think that's beautiful. Honestly, it's absolutely warmed my heart to see.
I think it's, at the end of the day, it's having compassion during this situation, also having a level of empathy and acting with empathy and putting your stuff aside and being like, you know what, to an extent, I might know how that feels, and therefore let me stand beside my black brothers and sisters or my black siblings. Yeah. And I think that's been really, really important. And I have seen so much support, but at the same time, I think there's so much more to be done within our community. And it's like you said, when there are people like Priti and Rishi and Sajid and Munira in government, it can create a divide, because suddenly some of the South Asians that actually believe in what they're saying and believe their stance are a little bit more vocal. You know, and it does create that disparity within our community. But I think you're right. I think it's been really, really beautiful to see us be supportive and in the right way and not make it about us.
What I think is interesting is that I think what black people are asking for, right, is to be judged as we are individual people, rather than to be collectively hated, rather than to be collectively set back, or pushed aside, or whatever the case may be. For instance, have you seen that picture of the black guy that was carrying out the white protester?
Yeah.
Everybody posting that on social media. I had very mixed feelings about that, and I'll tell you why. Because in my opinion, right, it's not, oh, black people are good, we're on our best behavior, so our lives should matter. No, black people's lives just matter. You get what I'm saying? Just as how there is a black man that would have carried that white man, there's a black man that might have put that white man in that position too. You get what I'm saying? Because we are not monolithic. You get what I'm saying? I can't speak for another black man or another black woman. We all have our individual feelings and perceptions. And I think when you talk about things like Priti and all of those other people, we have to all get to the point where we judge an individual on the morals and the principles that they stand on.
100%.
You get what I'm saying? Regardless of what color they are. And I think we are really coming to a time where people are going to stop judging things by whether it's successful, stop judging things by whether it's a good political move, stop judging things by whether it puts somebody in a position that they wanted to be in, and start judging people by, how do you sleep at night when you do that to get there? How do you sleep at night when those are your actions? Because no longer will you be able to hide behind politics or hide behind money. I think at this point in time, people are really starting to say, nah, but who are you as like a person though? Like who are you? Can you, when you sleep at night, do you think about how your actions affect others? And I think that that's happening for a lot of people. And I think it's, I'll tell you how it's happening for me. I just think one day I just got up and it's crazy because growing up and being born in Jamaica and seeing the level of poverty that I saw, because even for Jamaicans, even on a Jamaica level, I was poor. You understand what I'm saying? So the Jamaica as a country struggles financially, but even by those financially struggling standards, I was poor. And so I vividly remember a time in my life when I've walked down the road for water. I've done that. I've took a bucket, went to a tank, filled up the tank and walked back to a house with water. That's happened in my lifetime. I've lived that. So money has always been important to me, not for flashiness, materialism, none of that. I literally, the greatest thing about money to me is seeing it in my account and feeling financially stable. After watching my parents struggle with bills and different things for years and being in debt, it just feels good to know I'm good, literally. But even with all of that, and even with, because that affects my life in so many different ways, I don't feel like I can go on a holiday. I don't feel like I can take a break. It affects me in loads of ways. But even with all of that, it's like recently when this, when the George Floyd thing happened, I said, Bonnie, I said, nah. When I posted my first video about George Floyd, I said to myself, there is a possibility brands will walk away from me. There is a possibility this might be too politically charged for people to feel like they can work with me. And I said, nah, it's not even about the money now. It's about who I am as a man. Do you understand what I'm saying? And I feel like a lot of people are reaching that stage.
I agree, and I think that actually I've never felt like I could be so loud before. These are things that we've always believed in.
Yep.
But for like you said, I've seen in one of your interviews, you said, I've never seen a time like this in my life.
Never
seen a time like this in my life. And I feel like now, instead of us having to tie our words in ribbons and make it look pretty, we can say exactly how we feel.
Yeah.
And seize that opportunity, and like you said, transition from survival to actually, who are you as a person? How do you sleep at night? I couldn't agree with you more.
I'll tell you something, Joy. Because some people talk about, I hope this isn't a trend, I hope this won't go away. I don't think this will ever go away, because you don't know. When I say you don't know, I don't mean you. But some people don't know what it feels like to finally feel free to speak. Ooh, I don't think black people will ever shut up again. I don't think we will. I really don't, because this is the first time I'm telling this story. It's not a big story, but I walked into the radio station, and Mr. Jam comes on with Dance Anthems right after me. And He radioed into my studio, because obviously social distance and everything. So I'm in my studio, he's in his studio. And he radioed him in and he says, it feels good, innit? To just be able to like be free and talk now. And it's like, it hit me when he said that. It was like, it does feel good. It feels like we've been putting on, for lack of a better term, a white voice every day since we stepped into the corporate field. To make sure we don't misstep, to make sure we don't misbehave, to make sure we don't seem rowdy, to make sure we don't seem aggressive. Now that you've given us the opportunity to talk, you won't ever make us shut up again. We're not gonna go back to that. I'm feeling 100%. A freedom. I feel a freedom that I have never felt in my entire life. It's like something was in my, I remember when I saw that the officers were charged, and I understand that they haven't been sentenced yet, and obviously we're still fighting for that to happen. But I felt like a weight was off my shoulder that I didn't know was there. Because when you walk with a weight for long enough, sometimes you can actually live with it to the point where you don't understand that this isn't supposed to be on you. So you accept it as a part of your natural function. When I saw that us talking and speaking up actually had an effect, it felt like something dropped off me, and I felt physically, not metaphorically, I felt physically lighter in that moment. And I'm not gonna lie, I took the weight back up simply because I understand that the fight isn't over and we can't afford to feel comfortable. But for that second of putting that weight down, I'm telling you, it was a euphoric feeling.
Oh,
100. It's funny what you say about jam, because I'm actually, jam and I work together, and yeah. I've known jam for a minute, and I feel like, you know, the glances that we give to black, brown, Asian, whatever, brothers and sisters, mm-hmm. when we feel a type of way in a room, but we can't actually say something.
Yes, yes, yes. He's the master of that as well.
Yeah, you know the look. And, yeah. and I think Jam and I have exchanged that look a few times. So to hear him say to you, doesn't it feel good? Like, and that's a man I know that I've been in rooms with him in a industry kind of way, and we've just had little glances at times, da, 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 da. But to hear him say that, it's just, that says everything to me. Just on a
personal he'll never know how that hit me. He'll never know how that made me really think about the fact that I actually feel like I can say something now.
That's beautiful.
And I think it's beautiful. And I think,
it's
and
so
I think,
beautiful.
Yeah, and that's why I love everything about a lot of people speaking up now. I love the idea of women speaking up as well about what they've gone through, because we can't. I feel like 2020 is the year of revealing, of exposing, and
holding, you know, people accountable.
Holding people accountable.
Completely accountable.
And you know what? Yeah, it's like because I come from a I come from an ideology of forgiveness, right? I come from an ideology of peace. I come from an ideology of you can get back up from everywhere, from anywhere. Because in exposing, yeah, if you're a real person, because some people are fake, yeah. If you are a real person, yeah, you aren't going to just be doing the exposing. It will reveal stuff in you too. Yeah. You see, some people just feel like they stand on the side of right, okay? If you are a real man, right, that you might not have ever done something to the level of what somebody else has done, but you still have to check yourself if you're a real person, right? And admit to yourself, maybe there's a time I never moved perfectly right, or whatever the case may be. I don't feel like people should fear exposing and fear revealing because of maybe being cancelled or losing money or blah, 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 blah. No, no, no. What's more important is working on who you are as a person. Do you get what I'm saying?
100%.
So that you live good and you live right. You understand? I'll give you a perfect example of how I expose things within myself. Black Lives Matter is happening. And I'm fully charged. I'm amped. Black Lives Matter, Black Lives Matter. And I'm getting these DMs about Yemen. And I'm ignoring them. I'm ignoring all these Yemen DMs of people showing me the level of depravity that's going on there. And I'm ignoring it. And I'm like, Black Lives Matter. And then after a while, I said, bro, you're a hypocrite, you know. You're a hypocrite. And we're all hypocrites, but I hate feeling like one. Like, I just hate the feeling of feeling
yeah,
like
yeah,
one.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Especially when you have to check yourself.
Yeah, yeah. But I said, I can't ignore this no more. And I did speak on it. And I understand that we can't speak on everything. Do you get what I'm saying? I understand. But if you can do more, then try and do more.
Yeah,
is my whole thing.
I think I had that moment as well, because there's definitely what's going on in Yemen. There's the exploitation of workers in Bangladesh during this time. I know full well, because of having family in Bangladesh, that COVID is hitting it differently. And actually within our communities, there is a real shame to go around and say that you've had this virus, especially back home. You know, they'd rather say that they died of a heart attack than say, by the way, I have coronavirus because of...
I didn't know that.
Yeah, so neighbours... you know, because your neighbors might judge you, etc., etc. So, and obviously all the financial implications of coronavirus is real, and especially in a place like Bangladesh where poverty is rife. And so there's that, and I was trying to speak about that, and I had the same realization, you know, when this movement started, when George Floyd was killed, it was something just, I was here with Ezra, something just hit.
Mm.
You know, I looked at him, even after Ahmaud Arbery was killed, we were both here and we were trying to work and we were like, this doesn't feel right. Like, I felt like a hypocrite trying to write a song that was like about love, da, 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 when I just seen a video of a man in broad daylight, an innocent man, do nothing and be killed. Mm. And them man haven't even been arrested. Da, 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 and now obviously they have, but back then, and so we had that, and it was creeping up on us. And then when George Floyd passed, Ezra and I just looked at each other, and we were like, we need to, and it's exactly what you said, everything aside, I could be writing, my writing goes, it ends up becoming an album thing, I end up earning money, that financial stability happens, but that just, it stopped. And I messaged everyone at work, I said, I can't work, I need to do this, this is what I need to do. And actually, it's what you're saying, that felt like a hypocrite moment, because I couldn't go to my desk when I was trying to be, when I was trying to be prevalent in my work and be there and be present, I couldn't be. And I had to say to people I was working with, my brain isn't here today, it's somewhere else, and I need to address that. But then as it continued, as you see Yemen happening, Bangladesh, Israel, Iran even, you know, it's like you said, you can't challenge everything, you can't be the spokesperson for everything, but if you can in some way just use your platform, even if it means people are going to be, you're going to get on, you know, people are going to unfollow you, people are going to have something to say. You know, I've been posting stuff about Israel and the annexation of the West Bank, and I've had a lot of Israeli people message me who are like, you know, I'm a big fan of you, but da, 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 da. I'm a big fan of you, but you need to understand X, Y, Z. And, you know, I would rather, I've always said, if people don't like you, it means you're doing something right. It means you're 100% doing something right. We're not here to be everyone's cup of tea. That's definitely not the vibe. And I've never felt that more recently. I've never been so proud to have people go into my DMs and say X, Y, Z. Obviously, when it's productive, I'm checking myself. I'm reading the messages. I'm checking myself. I'm like, okay, this is how these people feel, et cetera, et cetera. But fundamentally, there will be people you do not agree with whatsoever.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Whatsoever.
Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, go on.
It's an indication when people are saying they don't agree with you, it means, and especially if it's something that you feel very passionate about, it fully means you're doing the right thing.
And I tell you, you described how I felt the day when I watched the George Floyd video perfectly. Literally, I woke up that morning and I tried to do a video per day. Like, I'll do a talking video, I'll speak on something. I woke up that morning and said, okay, it's time to do today's video. And I had nothing else in me. Literally, I can talk about anything. For me to do a video a day, I can literally pull something out of nothing. My body was entirely consumed with that. I couldn't have made, it was either I did a video about George Floyd or I did no video at all.
Yep.
That's literally how it felt for me that day. And it's right what you say, it's like, it's not just, you know, it's very easy for us as individuals to make that choice to not be liked by somebody. What I'm really enjoying seeing is corporations having to make that decision. Because when brands here have to speak out and say, listen, the death of George Floyd is wrong, you have to understand, that's a funny thing for a brand to say, because the officer has not been sentenced. So in a court of law, he's technically innocent until proven guilty. Do you get what I'm saying? The officer.
Yeah.
They're being forced to speak out on a situation that hasn't played out in court, because it's like, and you will offend. You will offend people when you speak out on social issues or speak out on where you stand. And this is why I've said to people, because you see, it's very easy for me, to say, oh yeah, speak out and rare, blah, blah, blah. I know that I know how to word myself in order to make sure that I offend the least people possible. I know that I know how to do that. I understand that I know how to do that. I'm not the only, but for us to all be heard in whatever issue we're speaking about, there are going to be people that I need to speak that will not be able to mince their words as well as I am, and they'll say something wrong.
But that's what you're saying about character, and everyone's character being different. Everyone's approach is different in this. Even if you look at the organizations of the BLM UK, BLM London, people are abolitionists, some people are reformists, then everyone has a different stance, and that has to be accepted just as much as well.
Yeah, but my thing is, if you don't speak, if there's something wrong with what you're saying, whichever side that you're on, if you don't speak, you can't be corrected on what people don't know.
Yeah.
And I've found with a lot of people, there's a lot of people that if we're in a room having any debate, like, let's take it down to just like friendship, Me and my friends will be in a room having a debate, and there are some people that will hold on to their view and not share it, because a view spoken is a view that can be challenged. If you keep your view in your mind, You have nobody to challenge you, and so your view stays intact and impregnable. But the second you speak it out, somebody could say, but wait, what about this? I'll give you a perfect example. I've said my whole life, if I ever have kids, they're getting beat. I'm not sparing the rod. That's what I've said my whole life. And one time I said that 8 years ago now, one time I was speaking about that on social media about corporal punishment. And this lady said to me, yeah, that when you hit your kids, yeah, it actually says to them that that's how conflict is supposed to be solved. So when I have a problem with something, I hit the person, and then that's how the person becomes corrected.
Yeah.
That makes total sense to me, that that could be how a child's mind perceives you hitting them.
Yeah.
Then when they go to school and somebody messes with them, oh, this person's done something wrong, I need to beat them too. Do you get what I'm saying? And it's like in that moment, I was forced to think upon the issue. I don't even still don't know where I stand, but I know I was forced to think. I was forced to think because I spoke out my view. Now, my view could be incorrect, but because I spoke, that allows me now to receive education.
Yeah.
Where I didn't receive it before. And yeah. I think that's why this encouragement is more to white people that are trying to be allies, because I'm telling you right now, if you kick somebody on the floor, yeah, or if it's hard to say if you, but if somebody that looks like you kicks somebody on the floor, yeah, and then you hold out your white hand to pick that person up, there are some people that will do that to your hand.
Yeah.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, I am. Yeah.
You still have to extend the hand, because what happens is some people try to extend their hand, and I've seen this happen a lot in my comment section. I saw a lot of white people try to be allies in my comment section, and you would have some black people that would shut them down. Mm-hmm. I don't want them discouraged by that. You have to understand that you're dealing with angry people that have suffered with hundreds of years of oppression that don't just go away. You understand what I'm saying? It comes back to how sometimes, yeah, when you have people going through mental health struggles, yeah, and then you will have friends that will make them feel like a burden. Bro, this isn't a one-time conversation or fix kind of situation.
Mm-hmm.
It's not. I'm sorry that you can't fix this with the one time. Do you get what I'm saying? But if you dismiss and give up, then you leave that person to suffer or to die. Do you get what I'm saying? So it's like, when white people extend their hand, and when white people speak up for black people, you might say something wrong.
Speak anyway. Don't let that discourage you.
Don't let that discourage you, and still talk. Still talk, because if you don't talk, if you've got wrong ideologies, you're saying something in the wrong way. Then guess what? This literally happened to me the other day. Stop me if I'm talking too much. I'm just a talker.
No, I'm taking it.
This literally happened in a situation the other day where I was doing a university chat, and the student one. We were talking about university stuff and my come up and my career, but there was lots of black students in the chat that had just seen me talking about this Black Lives Matter stuff, and one girl just decided bonnet, and she just let loose. The tutors are all in the chat, everything. She was just like, yo, this university don't care about black people. We're struggling with white supremacy and white oppression and systematic oppression and all of this. And she just blurted out. And one of the tutors was like, okay, we understand. We hear your issues and what you're going through, and we want to speak to you and blah, 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 blah. And I had to let the teacher know, when you're speaking to somebody about what they're going through, yeah, and they title what they're going through, and you reply back to them with generic statements or generic words like issues. If I say to you, listen, this university has a problem with white supremacy, and then you say to me, we're gonna talk about these issues that you have,
You're automatically undermining
and diminishing. I need you to say white supremacy back to me. I need you to use the same words that I used back to me, and don't call them my issues, the issue. Do you get what I'm saying? And so in that moment, I told that tutor that, and I didn't tell him that out of malice. I told him that because you don't want to take that kind of verbiage or that kind of response and bring it to a wider public that's deeply upset right now. So let's fix this in this little forum right now, so you can understand how to communicate with people. Because what happens is, and I can understand, he might have been worried to say the word white supremacy because he might not really know what that means.
Yeah.
And I myself wouldn't put my word to a phrase that I don't understand. But that just means you need to go and understand.
Yeah.
100. You need to go and understand.
That's why, yeah, I've been saying this a lot recently, yeah, that I am not so much looking for people to change as I am looking for laws and procedures and processes to be in place to hold people accountable. Mm. Because believing that we live in a world where people will do the right thing just because it's right, it's the right thing, is laughable. It's never been the planet. There has never been a time in human history where people have just, everybody has just in a monolithic way done the right thing because it's the right thing. People, a lot of people do the right thing because it is the law, okay? And that officer probably did what he did to George Floyd because he felt like there was no law that would stop him from doing so, because he felt like he was above the law, which is why I want laws to be in place. I'm not hoping for people to stop being racist. I'm hoping for racists to understand that I can't be racist because there are laws that will punish me if I do so. Because there are a lot of people that don't commit a crime because the law is there as a deterrent. You get what I'm saying? So I don't want to hear what you're teaching. If I was you, I wouldn't want to hear what you're teaching the kids. I'd also want to hear what happens when a student is subjected to racism by another student, because you have to understand what racism is. Racism, when you hit somebody with racism, you hit them with an existential crisis, because now you enforce an ideology in that person to feel like, I am going to be judged before I do anything. There is a problem with me simply because I dare to exist. You have to understand what it is. Because if a student was to hit another student right across the head, knock them out, right? You would immediately exclude such a student for a bit. So I'm assuming such a student would have to go home, okay? Because we view physical damage greater than psychological and emotional damage. But when you make a student feel like lesser because of the color of the skin or their race, you are affecting that person with potentially years of trauma, worse than if you had hit that child. So where is the punishment? Where is the punishment, and what is the punishment degree? Because if I tell you that students from your school are in a chat saying all lives matter to other black students, what's the conversation after that? Do you understand what I'm saying?
On top of that, not only saying all lives matter, but crocodile tears. Yep. Mm-hmm. Actual physical crocodile tears, not metaphorical. One of these students cried, a white student cried and said, "You don't understand." The words "you don't understand" to two black girls. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's just another existential crisis. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's like a layered cake of existential crises. Yep. Not only has she said all lives matter, she's saying you don't understand. She made accusations that white people have been killed by black people in the past. And it's like, I'm watching and I'm still yet to have spoken to, because I want to try and get in touch with the black girls' parents. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm not mentioning any names. I'm trying to get in touch with their parents because I feel like this is something that their parents should know is happening to them at school. Mm-hmm. But there's automatically this thing where I feel like I might be crossing boundaries. I might not be. Is that the appropriate thing to do? Should I be able? Surely the school should be telling the parents that this is happening to their children. So I've let it.
It would be vital too, so the parents can give their kids what you're not going to give them, which is confidence boost. I swear, people don't understand what racism is. You know, I swear, I don't think none of us have deep. What racism really is. There is a difference between when somebody hits you to hit you. Like, it's like when people talk about black on black crime versus racism.
I was gonna bring this up. It's fucking ridiculous.
You lot kill each other. Listen, if no matter how petty the problem is, if I'm a gang member, right, let's walk into their stereotypes, right? If I'm a gang member and another crew steals my drugs off me and I killed the person from the other crew, or hit the person from the other crew, that person understands why I've hit them. We had an issue. When you do something to somebody because of the color of their skin, that tells them that you live in a state of wrong. It's not if I do something wrong, or if I do something to you, then something happens to me.
You challenge their existence.
My existence is wrong. That's what you reinforce in a person's mind. So it's like, Twitter has cancelled a lot of black celebrities or black influencers who, when they were younger, have said things like, I hated being black or I wanted to be white. Even though that is a wrong thing to say, we have to understand the level of psychological trauma that does that to somebody that makes them even say something like that. Because in the mind of a young person that is still, listen, man, I don't think a human mind is molded fully until, I don't even know if I'm at the age yet. I'm 28 years old and I'm not sure I'm at the age yet where I can say a human mind has fully molded, okay? You don't know how long people hold ideologies for. A 17-year-old's mind can easily, through their life experiences, to be warped to feel like their blackness is a problem because of how society makes them feel over it, or whatever the color of their skin. So, it shows, I'll tell you how it shows. It shows in how we move. If I'm a black person that feels like I have to be on my best behavior and make sure that I don't seem rowdy and make sure that I don't seem this before I'm viewed as aggressive, that literally means that somewhere in my mind, I understand that in society, my skin tone will mean that I am treated differently. So how hard is it for somebody to correlate that to say, my skin is a problem, my skin holds me back? If somebody is not strong enough in their character and in their identity, they can easily look at themselves and say, my skin is a setback. Do you get what I'm saying?
Of course. But we see it in, you know, I saw an amazing poster sign in one of the protests, and it said, Priti Patel is traumatized by racism.
People ain't deep in it. People ain't deep in it. As
it's
much
so
as that
easy
person...
to cancel people.
Yep.
But compassion, yep. Compassion is the hardest thing. I'm not saying, God, yep, have compassion for Priti Patel. I'm saying, yep, that you genuinely, especially black and people of color, have to give, mm-hmm, them room to understand, yeah, where they've done wrong or what, yeah, they said.
Yeah, yeah. There is a root. Yeah. Those things don't just happen just like that. They come from a, like, do I want that person in a position of power? No. But after we take them out of the position of power because they're unfit, now we got to talk to this person and bring healing to the individual. What about the heal? What makes somebody go against their own? You have to deep the psychology. I'm like, we're all victims to this thing. Like, look at colorism and how they used to keep the darker skinned slaves in the field and the lighter skinned slaves in the house. That's where colorism comes from. That's where it is originating from. So now we beef each other based on something that white slave owners started within our mindset.
But there's that, but it's also, caste system has lasted for hundreds and hundreds of years. You know, like India, for example, has always had a caste system. Gandhi was very, very supportive of the caste system. He believed in caste system. And that also ties in not only with the color of your skin, but your class. Mm-hmm. And so, mm-hmm, you can see that colorism is like, it's been used all over the world. It's, yep, been used as it's a divide and conquer kind of thing, you know, and it really, really does. It affects our community so much. So much.
Definitely. There's a lot going on, but as I said, 2020 is the year to bring it all out.
100.
And to have those honest conversations, and conversations are getting really, really honest.
And what would you, go on.
No.
What are you doing to self-care, to be there for yourself? What are you doing to, because yes, you're charged, and yes, mm-hmm, and you're about, mm-hmm, to be charged forever. Mm-hmm. But, mm-hmm, because this is a conversation about mental health and also,
yes,
just current affairs, etc. I'm interested, mm-hmm, you as a black man during this, mm-hmm, time, what are you doing, yes, for yourself? When you're not on your Instagram promoting XYZ, you're not being a voice, what are you doing, mm-hmm, in your spare time to process, digest, and decompress?
Having fun. That's what I do. And I tell you why. I have the ability to put all of it down, no matter how deep it is. I will put, for my mental health, I'll put anything down. I'll take Black Lives Matter as an issue and be like, I'll come and pick you back up later. Whatever it is, and I'll tell you why I can feel comfortable in my mind to do so. I cannot give you happiness if I don't possess it. And this is what people need to understand. You need to be right first before you give right. You need to be good in yourself first before you give good, or else you might give something. Like, we have to be, I'm very, very careful, because I've been a person that has given advice all my life. And I've looked at the points in my life where I've given wrong advice and then somebody's turned in the wrong direction because I gave advice out of where I was and at that point. Yeah. So I'm very, very careful with how I speak because I don't want to give somebody something wrong that they might take.
Yeah.
Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So if I, let's say I'm too angry right now, too upset right now, I'm going to wait until I can properly process so that I can give it to you. Do you get what I'm saying? Now, because I've been doing this all my life, I can be angry and still speak with the aggression, but still speak sense because I've practiced doing this. But really, I do put things down. I'll put it all down. I'll tell you one thing here that people really need to learn how to put down: family issues. Because what happens to a lot of us is, we take up our family in our hearts, in our hands, and we feel
what is your process of putting something down?
I put it down. You see what I'm saying? Like, I don't even try to make sense of putting it down. I've just come to learn that the world spins. Once you put something down, the world still turns.
I mean,
turns and the sun comes up.
I used to do this thing, which is kind of makes me think of the putting it down thing. Sometimes I'd go to bed and I wouldn't be able to sleep because there was an issue on my mind, whether that was family or something to do with myself, et cetera, et cetera. So I would imagine that I was on a beach, any beach, didn't have to be a hot beach. And I dig out the sand and I take whatever it is that's pissing me off. I put it into a box, I put it into the sand and I cover it. And then the waves roll over it. And that just image of that box, you know where it is, you know it's underneath the sand and the waves are crashing over it, was enough to kind of keep me going. I think it's really easy. I'm going to check you here. I think it's really easy to put things down momentarily. But I think that sometimes, in my experience anyway, especially when dealing with someone, I've generational trauma exists massively in my family, as it does with many, many, many Black and ethnic minority families.
Yeah.
And I put one of my family members' projections onto me, always down, deflect, 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 deflect. But unfortunately, every wardrobe will get warped if you put too many clothes in it.
Yep.
So I had to find ways, and you know, therapy is an obvious way, but also visualizations like that beach thing. Exercise has been mad because endorphins is like the drug of getting rid of stuff. And I feel like I've had to use practice, not just putting things down, because I'm afraid of saying that, because actually I've done that and all it's done is created rage. And I'm not saying that's going to happen to you necessarily, because you've got your own way, but I think that for a lot of people, to some would call it suppression. I'm just going to suppress that out of my mind for now. I'll come back to it. But sometimes you don't come back to it because it feels good not to have to go back to it. And especially with family stuff, in my opinion, and it will creep up on you somewhere, someday. That's why people do CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy, and they're out here trying to work out stuff that happened in their childhood that they never wanted to address until they're 32. So I think we have to find ways of putting things down, but in a productive way, so it doesn't necessarily just come out of nowhere and swipe us.
I'll tell you, like, I've always been able to put things down. The family one was the so, like, when you spoke then, I thought about the fact that it has been easy for me most of my life to put things down, and I've been able to put down the social issues. But the family one, I literally only put down for the first time, I think, last year, because I love my family. I was like, it's like I realized something, it's like something clicked, and it was like, this wheel keeps turning. There are certain things that just keep spinning. and you keep trying to put your hand on the steering wheel and stop it from veering off, but it's like it doesn't stop. And I think sometimes it is very, very good to realize what's out of our control in life, mm-hmm. and what, like, sometimes we put too much responsibility on ourselves to fix things mm-hmm. that is kind of like beyond us to fix. And sometimes you have to just be like, live and let live. And I had to learn that massively in my life because I'm a control freak. And I'm a control freak because of how successful I've been at control. Do you understand what I'm saying? Like,
I hear you.
I have a very forceful personality. Like, right now, my closest friends to me are my friends because I forced our friendship to exist. Because I wouldn't let the passage of time, distance, and the fact that we knew each other in school make the friendship die. I just wouldn't let it. And now we're some of the closest of people and we talk almost every single day, even if it's just to talk in a WhatsApp group chat.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
I value those friendships so much, I refuse to let them. You know how some people just like, oh yeah, we used to be friends in school. I wouldn't let it happen. So I know how to really be forceful in making it, in creating the world around me. When you live the life that I live, where I think something in my mind almost every day, and then create it and put it on Instagram, that really reinforces the idea that thoughts become things.
Yeah.
So it was really difficult for me to wrestle with the concept that there are some things you just can't do nothing about, and you just have to let them be and live. And I'll tell you one of my ideologies that helped me. Yeah. I watched this Rocky movie, yeah, and I can't remember what Rocky movie it is, yeah.
Yeah.
But it's one where he's older now and shouldn't be boxing, and he decides to take up a fight, yeah. And his son stops him in the road. I said, "What are you doing? What are you doing with your life? Blah 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 blah." Blah. And his son's getting mad at him, and he says, "So I can't even remember what his son was saying to him, but he said back to his son, right? I've been boxing all my life. Let me tell you something, yeah. This ain't the real fight. The real fight is outside." Because nothing is ever going to hit you harder than life. Life is just going to hit you and hit you and hit you and hit you. You know what I'm saying? And when he said that, yeah, it really made me think about what life is. Because from the second that we are born, we start dying. And I thought about that concept. And it's not just physical things. It's emotional things. Relationships die. Where you used to live, where you used to be, old friendships, different things die. And it made me think about the fact that life really is designed to make us sad in a lot of ways, even in the ways that it's built to make us happy, because it's a roller coaster. Because some of the things that make us happy in life are the things that make us sad later when we lose them. Like, you get in this great relationship or something, and then you love this person, it feels so euphoric and it feels so good. But that same happiness is what makes it so sad when relationship ends. And that's when I realized that me personally, is how I see it. You really have to just be happy because happiness feels better than being sad. Like, you really have to, if you connect your happiness to any external thing, those external factors can change. They can always change. If I'm happy because of the career that I'm in, I could lose my job, or it could stop being as fulfilling. I see this happen to a lot of people that got success, and then in the heat of, they try to relive the heat of their success, and they can't just live with the fact that they're a legend. They go back and almost tarnish their own legacy because they want to be hot again.
Because they're searching for that feeling.
Yeah, they're searching for that feeling. And that's why my happiness has never been attached to my career. Honestly, I could go back to Landis. I could go back to Landis and stand behind that till again and still be happy, because I've just accepted, yo, I felt what sadness feels like. I felt what happiness feels like. I prefer this one, and understand that happiness has to at some point become a choice, because there is enough reasons for everybody to be sad.
I agree. I guess if you're like clinically don't have enough serotonin in your brain, it's a bit harder.
Oh yeah, of course.
100%. But I call it changing your head.
Yeah.
When I'm in a situation where I can change my head, I'll do it. I'll try my best. And you have to gather yourself and do what you said, exactly what you said. I can imagine you doing it in London and just going, this is how it is, and changing your head, yeah, and going, this is what I prefer. And I think that,
and you know,
that's so important.
What you just said, yeah, is one of the things that makes me the most sad when you speak of people that go through depression from a very clinical place, from a very scientific place. Like, I don't have that issue, and it's what makes me so sad when I see it, because as I said, I'm a control freak and I've got friends that have gone through it. I've got friends that I knew my whole life, that we sat and we talked, and then one day they just got sectioned. And I'm trying to understand it, because I only have a brain that says 1 + 1 = 2. Mm. And I can't, somebody asked me the other day, if there's something that I could change in the world, what would it be? And I think I said it would be that. If I could heal the mind, because it's so frustrating for a person like me to see people go through that, because all I know is willing things into existence. Mm. And so when I look at a situation, I can't help. I can't fix it with good advice. I can't fix it with sense. And it's like, it is a painful thing to watch a friend go through. Like, literally, you've known them forever and one day just...
Yeah.
Oh my God.
I've seen it many, many a time, and it's dangerous what your mind can do to you, you know? And that's why I stressed on, don't put things necessarily aside. Always have the time to address your shit, because you never know when that will take over you. Even if you're someone that's never suffered from mental health issues, da, 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 and your tactic is just pushing things, like, you, what was the expression you used? You just said,
I put it down. I always pick it back up, but I practice to put it down for a bit. And yeah. I think what happens is that people don't really put it down. I think that's what happens, because suppression to me and putting it down
are different things in your opinion. Yeah. And I think there's a blurred line in that for a lot of people. Yeah. Some of us really do feel like we're putting it down, and actually we just suppress it, and 2-3 weeks, 2 years, 20 years later, it comes in full force. And so
I'll be honest with you, I think the reason why I put stuff down is selfishness. I think I know within myself that my happiness is my most important thing. I'm very selfish about my happiness.
No, and it's beautiful, and I think we should all be very selfish.
I can't.
It's what you said. Lauryn Hill says, "How are you gonna win if you ain't right within? How are you gonna give to other people if you can't give to yourself?" And I think that's why, especially now, I'm asking my Black friends, my Black siblings, what's going on? How are you looking after yourself right now?
Yeah, definitely.
Because it is such a traumatic time.
I tell you, a white guy messaged me, and he's got this Black girlfriend, and he was like, "Bro, since this whole George Floyd thing happened, me and my girl have been going hard, posting, researching, talking, having conversations, but I'm looking at her and I can see that it's wearing her out.
Mm.
I can see that she's struggling, but because I'm white, I don't feel like I can say anything to her, because I don't want to offend her by saying put it down. And I know she'll feel guilty if she just has a rest and a respite. So because she's a fan of you, is there anything you could say?" And I messaged him and said, "Bro, tell your girl that I said, listen, you can put it down for a bit, and recharge, because the fight will be here and ready
when you
come back up again when you come back." And it hit me so hard that he didn't feel like he could say anything to his girl, because of obviously the position that he's in. He doesn't want to offend her, and she doesn't want to put it down, because she'll feel guilty within herself. But sometimes you have to live to fight another day.
I'm going to end it there, because I think that's a beautiful ending. I thought that's so tame. And thank you so much for being a part of this. Yeah. I feel like I have
to commend you on even doing this. I think it's absolutely amazing.
Thank you so much. I think it's important.
You could just be a successful singer. I think this is beautiful that you're doing this.